Hello everyone and welcome to today's live broadcast, Regulation of Actin During Cell Migration by Nucleotide Coding Sequence and Arginylation, presented by Dr. Anna Kashina, a professor of biochemistry at University of Pennsylvania. I'm Susie Valdez of LabRoots and I'll be your moderator for today's event. We're delighted to bring you this educational web seminar presented by LabRoots. LabRoots is the leading scientific social networking website and producer of educational virtual events and webinars. Before we begin, I'd like to remind everyone that this event is interactive. We encourage you to participate by submitting as many questions as you want at any time during the presentation. Just click on the green Q&A button located in the lower left of the presentation window, type your question into the box that appears on the screen, and we'll answer as many questions as we have time for at the end of the presentation. Also, please notice that you're viewing this presentation in a slide window. If you'd like to enlarge that window, just click on the screen icon located in the lower right. If you have trouble seeing or hearing this presentation, be sure to click on the support button at the top right or use that Q&A button and let us know you're having a problem. Good news, this presentation is educational and thus offers continuing education credits. Please click on the button in the lower left-hand corner and follow the process for obtaining your credits. Without further ado, I'd like you to join me in welcoming our presenter today, Dr. Anna Kashina. I will now turn the presentation over to her. Welcome, Dr. Kashina.
I'm going to tell you about our work on post-translational regulation of actin cytoskeleton by nucleotide coding sequence and arginylation. So this slide represents a flash animation of a running horse. So this is one frame of the flash animation. It just kind of illustrates in one picture the range of motions in biology. So our bodies move in many different ways, and cells inside our bodies move too. And all of this movement is largely mediated by the actin cytoskeleton. So actin cytoskeleton is the major driver of cell movement, and it forms major different structures in muscle and non-muscle cells. Both of these types of structures are uniquely adapted to the movements they mediate. So in the muscle cells, actin filaments form this periodic arrangement in the myofibrils, where they interact with the myosin filaments to mediate muscle contraction. And this is, of course, the macro scale of something that makes our bodies move. In non-muscle cells, actin cytoskeleton is also the major driver of movement. And it forms several different structures, some of them resembling the myofibrils, others completely different, which mediate a number of processes that lead to cell retraction and protrusion, and largely mediate their movement throughout the body. Excuse me. So migration is a very important process in all our lives. It starts early in embryogenesis. So migration drives tissue morphogenesis during development. It also mediates such major processes as blood vessel remodeling, neuronal patterning, immune response, and tumor metastasis. And all of these processes have actin as its root. So a lot of these processes are mediated by migration of non-muscle cells. And in this image, which represents a typical non-muscle cell, this is a skin fibroblast, actin cytoskeleton, which is highlighted here in red, forms a number of major structures throughout the cell body. So first you can see in this picture that actin cytoskeleton covers the entire cell. And you can also see that it forms different types of structures. So near the cell, in the center of the cell or towards the cell center, it forms this thick cable. Cables called stress fibers, which mediate the large-scale contractions of the whole cell. In addition to this, actin also forms this network at the very cell periphery, which highlights the cell edge, the ruffling cell edge. And this dense network of actin in the cell periphery is the one that drives the migration and protrusion of the cell leading edge. So actin, for all its complexity of functions, actin itself is a pretty simple protein. It's a small globular protein. And the only difference about it is that it's able to polymerize. So actin self-associates to form this type of filaments shown here. And these filaments underlie most of the structures we see in the actin cytoskeleton. So in a typical non-muscle cell shown here, The majority of that actin cytoskeleton in the cell body is represented by the stress fibers, which somewhat resemble the muscle fibers, and for the cell, they serve the same function as the muscle cells in our body. And another type of structure at the leading edge is the dense network of actin filaments shown on the right hand of the slide. So you can see that this network is very dense, and this network is the one that enables all the leading edge activity and enables the cells to move forward as they migrate. So there is a number of proteins and regulatory events that take part in facilitating the activity of this leading edge network of actin. So actin at the cell leading edge forms this branch network of filaments, and these filaments constantly polymerize at the very cell periphery, and this polymerization is actually the force that protrudes the cell edge, so they physically push the cell edge forward as the cell moves. And there is a constant flux of actin subunits from the back of this network, where they depolymerize, to the front, where they repolymerize again. And in this picture taken from the recent review by Coward and Borisi, there is a number of other proteins that are mediating this activity of the actin cytoskeleton. So all these events are precisely coordinated through the functions of many actin-associated proteins that are essential for this process. And while this area of actin regulation has been studied very extensively, actin regulation in general still remains a very much of an emerging field. And in particular, there are several mysteries related to the regulation of actin itself without the activity of the associated proteins. So one mystery is related to the actin isoforms. In mammalian systems, actin is represented by 6 different isoforms that are very functionally distinct, but they are over 99% identical at the amino acid level. So there is very little understanding of how the functional distinction is regulated. Second mystery concerns actin post-translational modifications. So there are 16 different post-translational modifications that have been shown to affect nearly every reactive residue on the actin surface. But very little is known on the about the functional consequences of this modification. And another mystery concerns specifically one of the actin isoforms, beta actin, which is one of the most abundant and uniformly expressed actin isoforms. In non-muscle cells, beta actin has been shown to be required for cell migration, and it must be specifically targeted to the cell leading edge to regulate cell migration. But nobody has a clear understanding of why exactly this is required. So here I'm going to pause in my introduction of actin and introduce protein arginylation, which is a post-translational modification that has been characterized very recently. And I'm going to show you the evidence today that arginylation represents a novel driver for actin isoform specificity and actin's biological function. So protein arginylation consists of post-translational addition of amino acid arginine to the proteins. And this modification has been discovered in 1963, a very long time ago, along with all these other post-translational modifications that we know very well and have been extensively characterized since then. But unlike all the other modifications, for the longest time, we knew almost nothing about arginylation. So it was completely unknown which proteins get modified by arginylation and what are the downstream effects of this modification. What happens? Why do proteins need to be modified at all? So arginylation is mediated by an enzyme called AT1, which stands for arginyl transfer enzyme. AT1 transfers arginine from tRNA to proteins. In all eukaryotes, AT1 is encoded by a single gene from yeast to human, and actually an exception is that in some plants, AT1 gene is duplicated and forms another gene, AT1-2, but it's very similar to AT1. So AT1 deletion leads to embryonic lethality in higher vertebrates, higher eukaryotes, starting with flies. So if you delete AT1 in Drosophila, it's going to be embryonically lethal. And if you delete AT1 in mice, it's going to be embryonically lethal too. And this is pretty much the state of the field that existed before we started our work on actin. So the focus of my lab overall is on protein arginylation and putting protein arginylation on the map and finding out where does it belong in the role of these all these other post-translational modifications and how does it regulate proteins. And at the start of this work, my colleagues and I discovered that arginylation is an essential biological process. So in collaboration with several other scientists, we produced a mouse 81 knockout, and we found that this knockout results in embryonic lethality. And this work was actually the first demonstration that arginylation is essential in biology. So this picture shows mouse embryos at embryonic day 14.5. So on the left is the wild-type embryo, and three embryos on the right are 81 knockout. So you can see that these embryos are much smaller than wild-type embryos. They look paler. They don't have very apparent blood vessels that can be traced under the skin. And the two embryos on the right have very large hemorrhages in the head and body. So in fact, the rightmost embryo was completely dead when the picture was taken. So 81 apparently is very essential. And so if you look at these embryos in more detail, you can see several major systems that are affected by the knockout of arginylation. So this picture shows cross-sections of embryonic hearts. So on the in panel A, it's a wild-type heart, and panels B and C on the, in the top row are the knockouts. And you can see that in the wild-type, the heart has a very thick myocardium, and it's a very well-developed four-chamber structure. So it has two ventricles and two atria, as it should be. And in the knockout, you can see that the myocardium in these mice is much thinner, and the septa between atria and ventricles are incomplete. So essentially, in this picture, you can see a two-chamber heart. So it's not fully separated. And in the bottom panel, there are enlarged areas of the myocardium from wild-type and knockout. And you can see that these knockout hearts appear thinner because their heart wall has fewer cells in them. So these types of defects in the heart are typically observed in mouse models with impairments in cell migration. And so we started thinking of cell migration early on when we saw this defect. So another defect in the 81 knockout embryos is defect in angiogenesis. So angiogenesis is the remodeling of the capillary network that results in the formation of the mature circulatory system. And in this picture, you can see heads of the E13.5 mouse embryos stained with an antibody which reveals the blood vessels. So on the left-hand side, you can see wild-type embryos. And on the top of the head, you can see this very well-developed capillary network. In the knockout embryos seen on the right, you can see the top of the head appears bald, so there are not very many blood vessels. So blood vessels don't grow very well into the areas where they're supposed to grow. And this process begins in the migration of the endothelial cells, so we're continuing the cell migration scheme. And then another picture here is the picture of the yolk sacs from wild-type and knockout, stained with the same antibody to reveal the blood vessels. And you can see that in wild-type, this area of the yolk sac that is enlarged in the bottom has this very orderly structure of blood vessels. It looks kind of like a tree with branches. And on the right-hand side, you can see in the knockout, a similar area of the yolk sac is not very well patterned. So you can see that the structure is much more disorderly. And this process also depends on the migration of the endothelial cells. So I'm seeing several defects in these embryos, which suggest an impairment in cell migration. So we started kind of at that point, and we started looking deeper into the defects in these mice. And we found that arginylation is essential for multiple developmental events. And many of these events depend also on cell migration, and therefore depend on the actin cytoskeleton. So in this diagram represents mouse development from E16.5 to E14.5. And it draws the scale. So in the E16.5, you see a small dot because this is how the mouse embryo actually grows during development. And at this stage, the embryogenesis critically depends on cell migration. So the events that are related to cell migration are listed underneath at different developmental stages. And through a number of mouse knockouts, my lab has now demonstrated that many of these events are affected by arginylation very critically. So arginylation appears to be a major regulator of cell migration and development. So our hypothesis is that arginylation is the master regulator of cell movement, and for the rest of the talk, I'm going to focus on the mechanisms of this regulation. So I'm going to tell you about actin cytoskeleton's regulation by arginylation. I'm going to show you our evidence that actin arginylation is essential for the activity of the cell leading edge. I'll show you that arginylation facilitates actin polymerization. I will show you that actin arginylation is tightly regulated. And I will show you our data how arginylation regulated cell migration regulates tissue morphogenesis in the mice. So as the first step in trying to identify the biological mechanisms of arginylation, we collaborated with the lab of Dr. John Yates, who is the leading expert on mass spectrometry and its biological application. He works at the Scripps Research Institute. And two scientists in his lab, Catherine Wong and Tao Xu, collaborated with us. So far, using this mass spectrometry-based screen, we identified over 100 arginylated proteins, which confirms the global biological role of arginylation. In non-muscle cells, we identified so far 62 arginylated proteins, of which 43 are cytosolic and 19 are nuclear. And remarkably, 11 of the 43 cytosolic proteins are related to the actin cytoskeleton. So this suggests already that arginylation really modifies actin cytoskeleton very much. So in muscle cells, we found that many of the key structural components of the myofibrils are arginylated. And of course, the myofibrils are another example of the actin cytoskeleton structure. So overall, our conclusion is that actin cytoskeleton may be extensively regulated by arginylation. And one of the first targets we ever identified was non-muscle beta actin. So we found that non-muscle beta actin is N-terminally arginylated, and N-terminal is a unique part which is different for this actin isoform from all the other actin isoforms. And over the course of this work, we found that arginylation of beta actin is tightly regulated and plays a critical role in cell migration. So I've already shown this picture before. This shows a non-muscle cell with actin cytoskeleton stained in red by a dye called rhodamine phalloidin. There is a toxin conjugated to a dye which binds specifically to actin filaments. So a remarkable thing about these cells is that they contain nearly equal levels of two non-muscle actins, beta and gamma actin. So in this red stain, you can see both of these actins together. And it's actually very difficult to distinguish them by any means. So beta and gamma actin in the cells, even though they are nearly equally abundant, are believed to be very differently regulated and to perform very different functions. So beta actin is specifically targeted to the cell leading edge. This occurs by mRNA-dependent mechanism. And therefore, at least at the onset of cell migration, it should very specifically incorporate into the leading edge, cell leading edge network. Gamma actin is not specifically targeted, and as a result, in the migrating cell, it's expected to incorporate mostly into the cell, into the actin network in the cell body. So these two actin isoforms are differentially segregated even before they are synthesized. If you stain actually migrating cells with antibodies to beta actin, you can see that beta actin, which is highlighted in green here with the specific antibody, is very much enriched at the cell, at the leading edge of the cells. So it will highlight the edge of every migrating cell as it moves. And in contrast, this red color, which is the same as the previous cell, showing a total actin cytoskeleton, will stain preferentially the cell center and all the cell center-related structures. So it has been shown through a body of work coming from John Candelins and Rob Singer that this localization of actin is mediated through zip code mediated localization of its mRNA. So it has been found very early on that beta actin mRNA localization to the cell leading edge is essential for directional cell migration. And this work is summarized in these two key slides coming from two milestone papers in this field. In this original paper from 2001 from Shostakova et al., they found that addition of antisense oligos to that perturb localization of beta actin to the cell leading edge abolishes directional cell migration. And in this work, which came over 10 years later, they found that this is specifically dependent on the zip code ADBP binding protein. So knockout mice with a knockout of the ZPP binding protein, actin localization to the cell and leading edges to the cell and directional migration of the cells is affected. But nobody really knows what is the mechanism of this. Why is it so important to have actin localized to the cell leading edge? So in our case, so we had a knockout of mice with a knockout of arginylation, and we isolated these migratory fibroblasts from these mice, and we looked at their migration and culture. And I decided not to show movies in this presentation, but just to show this morphology. But we found that knockout of ATA1 in cultured cells leads to very specific defects in their in the formation of their leading edge and in their directional migration. So a typical wild-type cell, when it migrates directionally, will form this very wide leading edge. So always leading edge will be protruding forward as the cell migrates. Then AT1 knockout, all this leading edge will collapse. The cell of this widely spread lamella, you have this kind of finger-like protrusions. So the cell does move, but it doesn't move as nearly as well as the wild-type cell. And it definitely doesn't have the same kind of lamella. And of course, this potentially could be a multiple defect regulated by the arginylation of multiple proteins. So to test the specific role of beta-actin arginylation and this regulation, we designed these two constructs. One is wild-type beta-actin, which has methionine at the N-terminus. And it's fused to the C-terminal GFP, so we can visualize it in cells. So we use this so-called ubiquitin fusion technique. So if you put ubiquitin moiety upstream of this construct, it will be cleared co-translationally by ubiquitinating enzyme to expose this N-terminal methionine at the N-terminus of the cell, of the protein. So you can use this technique to generate any N-terminal residue for a protein. So we mimic arginylated beta-actin by engineering arginine instead of methionine at the N-terminus of actin. And we made the same kind of fusion protein, except that the protein produced of this construct is going to be N-terminally arginylated by default. And then we transfected AT1 knockout cells with these two different constructs. And we found that, remarkably, transfection with methionine beta-actin, which is a kind of a normal version of beta-actin, pretty much does nothing to the morphology of this cell or to their migration. But if you introduce this permanently arginylated actin into AT1 knockout cells, it completely restores the cell leading edge and partially restores their ability to migrate. So this effect is quantified here, so the transfection of arginylated beta-actin restores the cell spreading and the lamellar length. So apparently this lamella defect in these knockout cells specifically depends on arginylation of beta-actin. Sometime later, we were able to generate antibodies to arginylated beta-actin. And we started, now we're able to stain cells with those antibodies and to really find out more about the functionality of this modification. So remarkably, we find that in migrating fibroblasts, so in this picture, F-actin is stained in green, so all the actins are the skeleton and the cell is stained in green, and arginylated beta-actin is stained in red. And you can see that the red stain concentrates very specifically on the leading edge of the cell. So it kind of resembles beta-actin localization, but it's even more specific. So so it appears that arginylated beta-actin is specifically enriched at the leading edge of the motile cells. And in this work, which is kind of ongoing right now, we also find that this localization can be abolished if the cells are not migrating, specific to cell migration. We next looked at the actin cytoskeleton and the leading edge zone. And in wild-type cells, remember I showed you earlier in the talk, there is a very dense network of actin cytoskeleton at the cell leading edge. So this is the dense network that protrudes the leading edge forward. So in the AT1 knockout, this leading edge network is a lot less dense. So there is much less actin polymer in the absence of arginylation. So we found that there is several fold actin polymer reduction at the cell leading edge in the absence of arginylation. And if you look at the structure of the actin filaments and actin monomers, so N-terminus that is arginylated is exposed at the outer surface of the actin subunits, and it remains exposed when actin polymerizes. So if you coat, if you introduce this arginylated subunits into the actin filament, it will result in this even coating of actin filaments with arginines, which are very bulky and positively charged. So it will significantly change the surface properties of the actin filaments compared to the normally acetylated form, which is negatively charged. So this kind of arginylation can significantly impact a lot of actin properties, including its polymerization, its ability to self-associate and bundle, and its ability to interact with different actin binding proteins. By doing in vitro polymerization studies, we found that non-arginylated actin subunits can form shorter filaments, so they are not elongating as fast as arginylated actin subunits. So, but there is more of it. So with the, our combined effect indicated there's an increased actin nucleation without arginylation, but decreased actin elongation. So you have a lot of short filaments as opposed to fewer but longer filaments. And this effect is quantified here. Another effect of actin arginylation on actin network relates to its ability to bind to the actin filament bind a capping protein. So capping protein would block the growing end of the actin filaments and prevent it from further growth. And we found that 81 knockout results in excessive capping of actin filaments. And this is demonstrated both in this platinum replica of the cytoskeleton, as well as in immunofluorescence and then co-sedimentation studies. So in knockout, you have a lot more capping, and this would severely limit the ability of actin to polymerize in vivo. So we believe that the effect of actin arginylation on the actin filament structure at the cell leading edge and then the actin network is combined between these different properties that are affected by arginylation. So lack of arginylation would induce abnormal actin polymerization, and at the same time it will increase actin capping, and we found that it also decreases actin severing, which means decreases turnover. So as a result, instead of the normal dense and very organized actin network, you will have scarce and disorganized actin network, which in turn will lead to leading edge defects and to impaired cell migration. So how is the cell migration driven by accumulation overall? So when a cell is stimulated to migrate, so one of the first events is this mRNA-dependent targeting of the actin to the cell leading edge. And at the same time, we believe that arginylation of this actin is also activated. So as a result, you will find a lot of arginylated beta actin coating the leading edge of your cell. And then as the next step, so this arginylation facilitates actin polymerization, so enrichment of arginylated beta actin at the cell leading edge will result in formation of this massive actin filaments, which will in turn enforce the protrusion of the cell leading edge and thus facilitate migration. The impairment of this event really affects cell migration. So the next question we ask ourselves is related to the actin isoforms. So the cells do have nearly equal levels of beta and gamma actin. So why is this regulation limited to beta actin and not gamma actin? This is kind of very puzzling when you looked at the structure of the amino acid sequence of beta and gamma actin isoforms. So this is the sequence alignment between beta and gamma actin. And all the identical residues are green in this picture. And all the different residues are red. So you can see that they differ only by four residues in the N-terminus. And moreover, these four residues represent homologous substitutions. So there are three D's here and three E's here. So these are both acidic amino acid residues, which don't differ that much in structure, and they also are both been shown to be favorable substrates for arginylation. So these two proteins are nearly identical, and they have similar biochemical properties, and they coexist themselves at nearly equal levels. So why are they differentially arginylated? So we consider three possibilities of why these could be differentially arginylated. And this work has been done by Fangyang Zhang, who was in my lab as a postdoc at that time, and now has an independent position at the University of Miami. So we considered, could this be due to specificity of AT1? Can it somehow recognize only one actin but not the other? So the other possibility is maybe this differential localization of actin isoforms somehow drives the differential arginylation. And then final possibility that remains But remember that arginylation in some cases facilitates protein degradation. So we thought maybe this differential arginylation is due to the fact that both isoforms are arginylated, but one of them is somehow degrading. And this didn't make very much sense to us at the moment, but we did put it on the list. However, during the subsequent studies, we eliminated these first two possibilities, and we were left with this one. So I eliminated this one because 81 is not really specific to us versus glue. It can arginylate both reactant and terminal. And we found that even though actin isoforms are somewhat differentially localized, they are not that differentiated. And 81, on the other hand, is localized everywhere, so this shouldn't affect the arginylation. So to test this one remaining possibility about the differential degradation, we used exogenously expressed arginylated and non-arginylated actin isoforms to follow actin's metabolic phase. And we found a very interesting thing. So actin is usually a very abundant and stable protein. So if you transfect cells with either normal and metionine, so that actin with metionine in the N-terminus, like I showed you before, or similarly prepared gamma actin with metionine in the N-terminus, which is the native form in the cell, both of them are pretty abundant, so you can have high levels of each of these proteins. But if you substitute this methionine with arginine to mimic arginylation, arginylated beta actin would still be very abundant, but arginylated gamma actin would be nearly non-existent. And for each of these lanes, we loaded equal mRNA levels, so equal transfection levels, so this is not affecting our observation. So somehow this arginylated gamma actin is very quickly removed from the cell. And then we looked again at the amino acid sequence, and we see that the amino acid sequences are not really different from each other. I mean, you remember, so they're almost the same. So then we couldn't explain the difference by amino acid sequence, so we ended up looking at the coding sequence. So this is the sequence of the coding region of the mRNA. And you can see that even though so in red, you can see that these codons that encode the different amino acids, in black are the codons encoding the same amino acids in both actin isoforms. But due to silent substitutions, which are indicated by X's underneath, these mRNAs are not really identical to each other. So they are different, in fact, by about 13%. And this was the biggest difference to go on. So we decided to test whether this mRNA coding sequence can somehow generate this difference in the stability of certain gamma actin. So we to test this hypothesis, we made 4-point mutations in the beta actin to produce a construct which is encodes beta actin, so encodes gamma actin protein by beta actin coding sequence, so the so-called beta coded gamma actin. And we did the opposite. We took gamma actin cDNA and introduced actually not 4 but 5-point mutations to produce this gamma coded beta actin. So again, this protein has beta-actin amino acid sequence but gamma-actin coding sequence. And this protein has beta-actin coding sequence but gamma-actin amino acid sequence. So if our hypothesis is correct and coding sequence somehow determines differences in their stability, then this change should reverse the stability of arginylated proteins. And remarkably, this turned out to be the case. So if you express arginylated beta-actin, which is encoded by the gamma actin nucleotide, it significantly decreases its stability. And in turn, if you take gamma actin, which is if you express gamma actin, which is encoded by beta actin coding sequence, you will make it much more stable. So somehow in this case, the coding sequence and not the amino acid sequence determines the differential stability of arginylated beta and gamma actin. So how can coding sequence define protein stability? So coding sequence can define one very important property, which is translation rate, or translation dynamics. And this can be regulated by mRNA structure or rare codons. But some proteins can be translated faster or slower entirely due to the silent substitutions in their sequence. So proteins that are translated faster also fold faster. They emerge from the ribosome much faster than the finished form. And proteins that are translated slower exist longer as an asymptote, and thus they are more vulnerable to degradation targeting, for example, by ubiquitination. And as it happens, arginylation is a known signal for recording ubiquitination. If you have arginine at the N-terminus and you have a vulnerable ligand, ubiquitin ligases will link with ubiquitinated protein and targeting the degradation by the proteasome. So, and this is how you can produce identical protein with different coding sequence and either degraded or not. So we tested the intracellular accumulation rate of beta and gamma actin, and we looked at stationary levels. So there is data right now that actually there are translations per unit of time can be very, very different from each other, but since both of them are abundant and stable proteins, the stationary accumulation of beta actin is only a little bit higher than gamma actin, but it's still considerably higher. So beta actin is indeed translated faster than gamma actin. And we also tested the ubiquitination of arginylated beta and gamma actin. And we found that arginylated gamma actin is much more ubiquitinated than arginylated beta actin. And I'm skipping a number of experiments here just to show you the conclusions. So we found that this so beta actin is translated and folded faster. And as a result, when it's arginylated, it escapes the degradation by ubiquitin proteasome. And we generate the protein that is arginylated. And this happens because there is a vulnerable ligand very close to the N-terminus that actually gets buried in the folded protein structure of actin. So gamma actin, which is translated slower, cannot escape this mechanism. So when it's arginylated, it's still unfolded, so it's immediately targeted for ubiquitination and degradation. So in this case, this ubiquitin-dependent degradation serves as a selection mechanism to ensure that only the correct actin isoform is arginylated. So our conclusion from here is that arginylation is specific to beta-actin because of the unique structure with mRNA, which is mediated entirely by silent substitutions in the actin sequence. So so this adds kind of another piece of puzzle to this diagram. So cell migration as a result is driven by mRNA-dependent beta-actin arginylation. And finally, in the last couple of slides, I wanted to show you how it applies to in vivo. So if you have, so if beta actin is so important for cell migration, then it definitely should affect cell migration in the body. So first, we did, so this is still an in vitro experiment, we just compared directly the rate of migration of wild type and AT1 knockout cells. And we found that wild type cells on average might migrate about 4 times faster than knockout. And then we made a conditional mouse knockout, where knockout of AT1 is driven by Wnt1 promoter. Wnt1 promoter is specific to migratory neuropressed cells, which are the cells that migrate for long distances and the longest ranges to mediate patterning of major structures in the body. So this picture shows lineage tracing of this knockout. So in this case, we crossed this mouse with a reporter mouse, which is expresses beta galactosidase under the same promoter. And this expression activates during the combination events, but also deletes AT1. So all the cells which are expressing Wnt1 promoter in this case will be detectable by X-gal, which is a substrate for beta galactosidase, and they will turn blue. In this case, almost black because it's very dark blue. In wild type, these are all the Wnt expressing cells highlighted by this method. And if you enlarge this area, which is the back portion of the embryo, you can see the stream of cells. So yeah, this is embryonic day 10.5. You can see that cells migrate in the streams from the back to the front of the embryo. And this is a very prominent event which drives the formation of all the craniofacial structures. So in AT1 knockout at the same stage, you can see a range of defects, and all of them are defects. So in this embryo, there are very few cells, and very few of them are migrating, actually. So here there are some more cells which are expressing Wnt1, but they're migrating very poorly. You can see no defined streams of cells. And even in this embryo, which is kind of the best of the embryos we found, you can see that even though cells do migrate in streams, they're not migrating as prominently as here. So apparently, AT1 knockout really drives cell migration in the embryos and in the body. And in this work, we found that this migration drives the formation of all the craniofacial structures in the embryos. So So this WNT181 mice have major craniofacial defects, which resemble some of the congenital defects in humans. So overall, all this work is introducing another player into this already known diagram of actin regulation of the cell leading edge. So now we know that actin is also arginylated, and this arginylation is a key event that is integrated in all these other dynamic events of the cell leading edge. And of course, it puts another milestone on this map. So we now put arginylation on the map in some way, and we found how it drives actin cytoskeleton and cell migration. So I'm going to stop here and acknowledge the great team of people who did this work. These are my lab members at the time. I've shown you a lot of their work, and they're all listed here. So these are our collaborators who did mass spectrometry from Dr. John Yates' lab. And the platinum replicas I showed you were from Tatiana Sitkin, who also works at the University of Pennsylvania. And all the actin polymerization studies were done in collaboration with Dr. John Dawson from the University of Guelph in Canada. Here are some of our finding sources. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much for your presentation, Dr. Kashina. And now we'd like to start the live Q&A portion of this webinar. If you have any questions for Dr. Kashina you'd like to ask, this is the time to do so. Just click on that green Q&A button at the lower left of your presentation window. Type in your questions into the box that appear on the screen and click the send button. We'll answer as many questions as we have time for. Let's get started. We have a great audience today, and we have a couple of questions already asked. Our first question from our audience member is actin arginylation reversible, Dr. Kashina?
So the question I just received is actin arginylation reversible? And it's a great question because, of course, any regulatory modification becomes even more significant if it can be reversed. So we do have evidence that there is an activity in cell extracts which can remove post-translationally added arginine. So we do believe that it's reversible. We also have evidence that actin arginylation is highly dynamic, so it can activate within minutes from the application of cell migration stimuli, such as serum stimulation after starvation, and it can also disappear over time. So we believe that this is a dynamic modification, and it can be rapidly regulated, probably tested within minutes, but I believe it could actually occur much faster. So we hope soon to identify the enzyme responsible for this regulation.
It looks like we have one more question from our audience member. Is this type of actin regulation common to different cell types?
So yeah, the question is the type of actin regulation common to different cell types? And yes, we believe it is common. So first, we were talking about non-muscle cells. And I was showing very genomic cell, which is a fibroblast. So neurocrest cells are also very similar. But our recent very exciting data shows that the same regulation probably happens in the neuronal growth cones, which is another model of non-muscle cell migration. So a neuronal growth cone really resembles a fibroblast in terms of the leading edge, even though it has some important differences. And we believe that the dynamics of the neuronal growth cones and neurite outgrowth depends on the exact same mechanism as the one that I showed you today. So we believe that this mechanism has to be global and generic to all the cell types that depend on their path into their migration. And of course, we also find that regulation of other actin isoforms participates in other functions in the body. For example, we also found actin regulation is important in the heart muscle and in the skeletal muscle contraction.
I want to once again thank Dr. Kashina for her presentation. I'd also like to thank LabRoots for making today's educational webcast possible and for our great audience members today. Thank you for joining us. Before we go, I want to let everyone know that today's webcast will be available for on-demand viewing through December 2017. You'll receive an email from LabRoots letting you know when the webcast will be available for replay. Please share that announcement with your colleagues who may have missed today's events. That's all for now, and thanks for joining us. Enjoy the rest of the conference. We hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.